Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. We're going to be conducting a webinar on how to navigate the application for the Provisional Day Habilitation Certification. My name is Kate Yankitis. I am a Quality Assurance Coordinator for the Division of Developmental Disabilities. I work for the Office of Quality Improvement. I oversee the Provisional DHAB application process as well as the ongoing DHAB certification process. Here with me today is our quality assurance staff. We have Tashia Frazier and Noelle Kerr, who are our quality assurance staff for our northern region. We also have Denise Turner-Byfield and Jennifer Manning, and they are our quality assurance staff for the southern region. Both Tashia and Denise are going to be assisting in the presentation this afternoon. The first thing that we really just wanted to kind of go over is that we decided that we really needed to put something out there for the providers. We've been receiving the Provisional DHAB applications for about a year now. We've received numerous applications. A majority of them required multiple revisions and had to be resubmitted several times. A lot of technical assistance has gone on and been put into this process. And because of this, we really wanted to provide an opportunity for potential applicants or applicants that are going through the process right now to really kind of gain a better understanding of what the requirements and expectations are of this process. So with that, we're going to kind of be going over all of the different areas of the application, starting with the whole purpose of DHAB certification to begin with, the definition of dehabilitation, the application requirements, which include the service delivery plan, the activity calendar, required policies and procedures. We're going to talk about the interview process, the facility inspection, as well as when we issue provisional certification. We'll also be talking about what happens the first year of certification and then answer any general questions that you may have. We're going to take all the questions at the end. We'll have an open question and answer session, but our hope is that we answer your questions throughout the content of the presentation. So first and foremost, we just wanted to let you know that the purpose of certification is really to assure that DDD Medicaid enrolled providers meet the minimum standards at the time of the application. And in addition to that, that they provide consistent quality dehabilitation services to the individuals served. And they do that by operating in compliance with the dehabilitation standards that are outlined in both the Supports Program Policy and Procedure Manual, as well as the forthcoming Community Care Waiver Policy and Procedure Manual. It's very important to know that we keep referring to the Supports Program as the one and only service out there, but the Community Care Waiver is also going to be backing into this. So all dehabilitation providers, regardless of the funding source, whether it be through the Supports Program or the Community Care Waiver, are all responsible to maintain and obtain dehabilitation certification. So prior to applying to become a DDD Medicaid DHAB provider, all potential applicants must obtain the Provisional Dehabilitation Certification. We have had several applicants come through Medicaid and they did not submit this certification, so you will not be able to move forward until you first come through this process. This basically is saying that you have met the minimum standards to provide this service. And then ongoing, there is no DHAB provider that can operate unless it has it's been approved through this process and it has a current certification. So in addition to provisional certification, there's also going to be an ongoing certification process that all DHAB providers must obtain and maintain. One of the first questions that we've had or issues that we've had is really people understanding what the definition of dehabilitation is. Dehabilitation, you can look on page 78 of the Supports Program Policy and Procedure Manual if you want specifics, but we're going to kind of break it down for you. The definition of DHAB is services that provide education and training to acquire the skills and experience needed for individuals to participate in the community. It needs to be consistent with their service plan. The services should be taking place during the daytime hours, and they can be up to a maximum of 30 hours per week. Day habilitation services can be provided in a center or in the community or a combination of the two. At this point in time, we have a real heavy emphasis on making sure that our individuals are in the community as much as possible. So you're going to see a lot of focus and emphasis placed on that when you submit some of your documentation. You cannot just provide day hab services 100% community-based. At this point in time, the communities for Centers for Medicaid and Medicare Services are requiring that individuals be afforded a majority of time spent in the community. So we're going to be looking to make sure that activities that you submit on your activity calendars provides our individuals with the opportunity to be with the general community. Day habilitation also has to offer and provide an opportunity for our individuals to develop appropriate social skills, behavior skills, and interpersonal skills, and also increase their opportunity for independence and personal choice. One of a new change to day hab from our old system is the term day camp is now falling underneath day habilitation. So what this means is that anyone who is currently providing a day camp and is funded through the division will now be considered a day habilitation provider, which will require them to go through this provisional day habilitation certification process. It will also require them to maintain ongoing certification. So for all intents and purposes, the term day camp really goes away. Rather, it really becomes a short-term day habilitation service. One of the things we do want to speak about is what is not day habilitation, what we're seeing a lot of in some of the applications that are coming through. Day habilitation is not vocational training, it is not employment, it is not job training. Volunteering, while it is allowable in day habilitation, it should not be volunteering that has any type of job or vocational skill training associated with it. The volunteering really should be about having opportunities to make community connections and to give back to your community. At this point, I'm going to turn the presentation over to Tashia Frazier. She's going to discuss further the application processes and some of the ins and outs and some of the issues that we've been finding.
Hi, I'm Tashia Frazier. I'm a quality assurance specialist who reviews applications for the Northern Region. And I'll be discussing part one, which is the application, which is essentially the paperwork. The first component of the application that we look for is your service delivery plan. Your service delivery plan should be an overall description of your program. It's important because it provides your program structure, and it also gives potential participants an idea of what to expect at your program. Your service delivery plan should describe your agency's goals and objectives. It should also highlight the types of activities that are offered at your program. Last, your service delivery plan should include general information, such as your hours of operation, the location of your facility, and the maximum number of people you serve. After reviewing your service delivery plan, we look at your agency's activity calendar. The activity calendar should include a variety of choices and options that foster the development of habilitative skills while also incorporating individuals' needs and individuals' preferences. The activity calendar is important because it provides structure for your staff and individuals because it helps outline your staffing needs. So what we're looking for are activities that help individuals ultimately connect and develop relationships within the community. For instance, if you have the mall as an activity listed on your calendar, we want to know what skills are being developed and reinforced, such as money management, like making purchases, or enhancing communication skills. In addition to the mall being an option for individuals to choose from, we want to see that they have a variety of things to do. So maybe someone wants to go to the park, or maybe someone else wants to go to the library. So these are things that should be listed on the activity calendar as different choices and options for participants to choose from. So after reviewing your service delivery plan and your activity calendar, we look at three specific policies and procedures. The three policies and procedures that must be submitted at the time of your application are personnel, emergency, and transportation. While there are other mandatory policies and procedures that your agency is required to have, these are the three that are required at the time of the application. So let's talk a little bit about personnel policies and procedures and what we expect to see. Generally speaking, your personnel policies should be the guidelines, instructions, and actions necessary for employees who work at your agency. They should outline your employees' responsibilities as it relates to human resources. Please note that we're not looking for just an employee handbook. Instead, we're looking for job descriptions for all of the positions at your agency. The job description should detail staff responsibilities and staff duties. We also want to know what your education and experience requirements are for your staff. In addition to this, we look to see that you have a system in place for conducting background checks. Background checks should be completed upon hire and as needed thereafter. Along with your background checks, we want to see that you have a system in place for conducting employee evaluations. What is the criteria for assessing job performance? How often are these evaluations performed? And then to take it a step further, how are these evaluations used to improve staff retention, employee morale, and job performance, ultimately to benefit the individuals that you serve? In addition to this, we want to see a system in place to ensure that all staff receive mandatory DDD training. Mandatory DDD training is currently offered through the College of Direct Supports. The College of Direct Supports is an online training curriculum used to develop and enhance the skills needed for anyone working with individuals with disabilities, developmental disabilities. Please know that you'll be granted CDS authorization once you become a Medicaid-approved provider. And then the last component of your personnel policy should be your table of organization. The table of organization should ensure a chain of command within the agency. It should also explain the responsibilities within the agency and clearly illustrate who reports to who within the agency. We're not looking for resumes. We're not looking for specific names of employees. We're looking for positions to be listed on that table of organization.
I just wanted to make a point that recently there was a training guideline that was submitted that was put out in the DDD communications, and it's really important that you, if you're not already signed up for the DDD communications, that you do that. The training guideline that I'm referring to is called the Reference Guide to Mandatory Staff Training and Professional Development. You'll see it in the slide that was previous to this one. Here we have it now. So if you go to that link, you'll be able to actually see all the mandatory staff training that's required now. There are some subtle differences from the supports program manual that's online at this point in time. So we highly recommend that you go to this, and if you haven't already, update all of your training requirements to make sure that it adheres to these new requirements.
Okay, so the second policy that we look for would be emergency procedures. Emergency procedures are critical because they establish how staff are required to respond and what's expected of them in the event of an emergency. Emergency procedures avoid potential harm to program participants and to employees. At minimum, your emergency procedures should include staff roles and responsibilities during certain emergencies, fire emergencies, medical emergencies. What are staff required to do? Who are they to call? How do they notify DDD? How do they notify families and guardians or support coordinators, etc.? Your emergency procedures must be in compliance with Division Circular Number 14, which is Unusual Incident Reporting, or UIRs. It also should be in compliance with Division Circular 20A, Danielle's Law, or Life-Threatening Emergencies. Some types of emergencies that we've seen are maybe someone eloping from program. There could be a power outage at a program. Someone could have potentially gotten into maybe cleaning products and consumed cleaning products. So these are the type of emergencies that you want to be prepared for and that you want to have guidelines for your staff to follow should they occur. And then the last policy and procedure that we look for with your application would be transportation. Transportation includes anything related to transporting individuals to and from day program and out into the community. Your transportation policies and procedures should include, at minimum, training requirements for staff on the proper use of safety equipment, such as wheelchairs or wheelchair lifts. They should also include what to do in the case of a motor vehicle accident, the forms to be completed, how the staff should keep participants safe, who to call, etc. In addition to that, we want to see that you have a policy for pickup and drop-off times. How long are your staff required to wait for individuals when they arrive at their homes? How do you establish supervision requirements? For instance, does someone need curb-to-curb supervision, or do they require door-to-door supervision? In addition to that, we want to see that you've identified your catchment area in your transportation policies and procedures. Let's spend a little time talking about your catchment area because we've had some issues with this with some of the applications that we've received so far. So your catchment area should be clearly defined, and you should also have justification for your catchment area. For instance, if your program is located in Essex County, or more specifically Newark, which is a densely populated city, you may define your catchment area as 10 miles because you can access most of the people that would be interested in attending your program in a 10-mile radius. But if you live, or if your program's in a more rural area, you might want to extend that catchment area to, say, 15 miles or perhaps 20 miles so that you can access more people. Please know that transportation is required, so it's included in the rate. So anyone who is located in your defined catchment area, you're required to provide transportation to. However, if you choose to provide transportation to someone who does not live in your catchment area, you can do so, but you have to become a transportation provider and bill for that separately. I'm sure we're going to get a lot of questions on that, so we can come back to that, but I want to continue to some of the other requirements for your transportation policies and procedures. So suspension guidelines are something that we look for. We want to see different reasons for suspensions. For instance, there could be a behavior issue on a van that potentially affects the health and safety of other passengers or of the driver. So we want to know, how do you handle that? Who's notified of the suspension? How long is the suspension? And what is being done to prevent and avoid some of that behavior moving forward? We also want to see an appeals process. So if someone's suspended and they feel like they should not have been suspended, who do they contact? What do they do? So we want to see processes and guidelines for that. And then last, there should be some information regarding cancellations. Cancellations could be because of environmental factors, like there's no heat in the facility. How do you notify the families? What's your time frame? Other cancellation reasons could be weather related. For instance, the blizzard that we're expecting this weekend could be a potential reason for closing a facility or closing a program. How do you notify families? How do you arrange transportation in those situations? Also, how do individuals notify your agency should they not require transportation that day? do they need to call 2 hours before? Do they need to call 24 hours ahead? These are the things that you need to establish and have guidelines for in your transportation policies and procedures. So you've completed part one of the application. You've submitted your service delivery plan, your activity calendar, and the necessary policies and procedures. So then the next steps would be the interview process. And Denise Turner Byfield will be discussing that component of the application.
Good afternoon. My name is Denise Turner Byfield, and I am a quality assurance specialist here at DDD. And we are going to discuss the next step in this process, which is the interview. So like Tishia said, once you've completed the application, once it's approved and all the corrections have been made, we will schedule the interview with you at a local DDD office. And the purpose of the interview is to elaborate on what was submitted. So think of the interview actually as an extension of what was in your application. So we'll discuss at the interview specific components of your program as well as your application. We'll review your activity calendar, how it relates to service plans and individual choices. Also, how your activity plan relates to your service delivery plan as well. We'll discuss with you plans for your future. What are your plans on opening or expanding to other places or other services you plan on providing? And how you plan on measuring quality. So what are your staff evaluations going to look like, as well as your individual evaluations? How will you determine whether people are happy coming to your program and how to improve? In addition to all of that, we'll discuss with you your policy and procedure manual for your agency and offer you some technical assistance and best practice recommendations. What we want to do is ensure that once you've finished with the interview, you'll be able to provide services in compliance with the DAHAB standards. Once the interview is completed, if you have a site, the division will schedule a facility inspection with you within 45 days of that interview. Okay, if you don't have a site, if you don't have a facility, you'll receive a one-year certification, but you'll have to let us know once that site is secured, so once you've leased or purchased a facility. Now, if you don't obtain a site within 1 year, you'll have to submit a new application and begin the process all over again. And it's important to remember that people will not be able to select your agency until you've completed this process. The next step is the facility inspection. And the purpose of the facility inspection is to ensure that you're operating in the safest manner possible. So we aren't looking for bricks and mortar because that's already been completed via your CO inspection. And keep in mind that we'll not come out to your facility until you've signed that lease or you've purchased that building. We do want to make sure that your facility is expected to be ADA compliant and follow the HCBS federal rule as previously stated. So no residential homes or areas, no nursing homes or residential facilities. If you find an old Victorian home, that's fine, but it needs to be zoned commercially. It cannot be a house that someone is actively living in. You can, though, rent a space in a larger office complex or in a larger office building. That would be okay. But you want to keep in mind the people that you plan to serve and make sure that that facility is appropriate. So if you plan on providing services for people in wheelchairs, you may want to avoid a second floor. You want to consider a changing area if necessary. You also want to consider make sure that you have adequate storage, so medication storage, cleaning supplies, storage for food. Also, the facility inspection will not be completed without your certificate of occupancy, so it needs to be there at the time of the review. We're also going to review look at your fire evacuation plan, as well as making sure your exits are clearly marked. Your facility review, though, will not be a surprise because you'll get a copy of the checklist prior to the site visit. So once you've completed the interview and the facility, what happens next? If your program is in full compliance, we will issue a provisional certification, which is valid for 1 year. And when we say full compliance, it means that all corrections or deficiencies have been addressed. there's any concerns that were discussed at the time of the facility review or at the interview, those have been addressed and corrected as well. Remember that your certification is site and address specific. So if you move or open a new site, that certification is now void or invalid, okay? Your certification, though, will allow you to apply to become a DDD Medicaid enrolled dayhab provider. And the link is here.
We do have a question right now just asking about whether or not the certification transfers with the, if the program site should change. And Denise did touch upon that, but I think it's important just for everyone to understand that you're not going to, you know, should you change addresses and find a different location, you're not going to have to go through the entire process again. What we want to do is make sure that we do things in a reasonable way. So what we're going to request that you do is that you let us know what site you're planning on moving to so that we can come out and we can conduct a facility review prior to you going, or actually when you go there, because you would have had the CO. So once we've done that and we've conducted the facility checklist, then what we'll do is we'll update that certification to reflect that new site. And you'll be good to go. If you go out and you move and you don't notify us, then there's going to be issues because we don't have the proper address. There's going to be issues associated with your billing. So it's imperative that you let us know when you're going to move that site so we can start coordinating our efforts to make sure that everything is done in a timely manner. If you are looking to open up a brand new site that has not been certified at all, then you will have to start at the beginning of the provisional application process. Just wanted to make sure that that was clear.
Okay, so now, things are going well, you're providing services, your program is growing, and you have great staff. What happens next is the DDD will return within the first year to do a full programmatic audit. And the full programmatic audit includes everything, so your personnel records, records of the people that you serve. Another facility inspection will also review with you all of your policies and procedures again. Once that's completed, the team will conduct what's called an exit meeting with you, and that summarizes the findings, and a full compliance report will follow. You'll receive a 1 to 3 or 3 year certification based on that compliance report, and we'll offer you technical assistance when necessary. And we are always available, so if you always have any questions or anything comes up during that time frame, we are available to ask. Keep in mind, though, that DDD does reserve the right to conduct a program visit at any time. So we may come out before that year is up if we have some concerns or if there's some questions that arise during that time frame. So once you are a DDD Medicaid enrolled dayhab provider, your agency is expected to be in full compliance with all dayhab standards at all times. So, and remember that there are additional expectations outlined in the supports program manual as well as the forthcoming community care waiver manual. So you want to make sure that you become familiar with those manuals as well as sign up for DDD communications so that you know as things change and you're kept up to date. These are some resources that we have found that have been helpful in the past, resources for the certification process, for the division circulars, also for becoming a Medicaid provider and Medicaid claims, as well as the fee-for-service link. One link on here that is very important is the dayhab application. It should be sent return receipt so that you know that we have received it. Sometimes emails don't go through, things happen, so at least that way you can ensure that it was received.
Yeah, unfortunately, a lot of the applications that are coming through, I guess they're beyond the maximum capacity of our email. So unfortunately, there's been some applications that have been submitted to us by the provider, but we're actually not able to see it, and we have no verification that it was ever even sent to us. So if you do not receive a response timely after your submission of the application, and by timely I mean in about a 1 week period, please contact or reach out to me directly, Kate Yankaitis. My email information and contact information will be available on the next slide.
So again, if you haven't received confirmation that it was received, like Kate stated, please make sure you reach out to her. as well as there are handouts that are also attached to this webinar. So there's a sample job description for you to utilize. Make sure you're not copying it verbatim. You're not using just that. We are looking, that's just a guideline for you. Also, there's a sample activity calendar, to use as a guide when you're planning your activities and developing your activity calendar for the month. And there's also a copy of the facility inspection that will be available as the attachment as well.
And if there's anything that individuals, the agencies, any questions that you have that you don't really feel were addressed, if you'd like, please feel free to contact me. My name is Kate Yankaitis. My email address is right up on the screen. It's Catherine with a C, and the last name is Yankaitis. You can spell that. It's a difficult one. But just give us a call, and we can answer any questions that you may have. Thank you for joining us.